Blackstone Audio presents Sanctuary, Book 2 of Nomad, by Matthew Mather. This book is read by Keith Szarabajka. Part 1. November 1st, 8 days AN, after Nomad. Chapter 1. A bullet ricocheted off the open truck door.
Get out!
Jessica Rollins screamed at Luca and Raphael. The faces of the teenaged brothers shone white in the dim light, their eyes wide. A second bullet punched a frosted hole through the windshield and lodged itself in the metal screen behind the seats. Jess crouched lower and stole a glance around the door.
Andare!
She yelled. That did the trick. Keeping low, Rafa slithered over the driver's seat, opened the opposite door of the Humvee, and disappeared. Luca climbed over Jess and gracelessly tumbled into the dirt and snow at her feet. Jess pointed at her own eyes, then at a pair of twisted metal and bricks 10 feet away. 1, 2, she mouthed silently, and on 3, she swung around the truck's door and squeezed the trigger on her AK-47. Pop, pop, 2 controlled rounds. She felt Luca move behind her and fired again, then rolled through the gray snow to scramble next to him. Rafa slithered on his stomach to join them. A bullet whined overhead. She had sensed something was wrong the moment they drove up to the bottleneck in the road. A jumble of car parts blocking the street seemed a little too neatly placed. She'd stopped short of the road's choke point, but there had been no easy way to back out.
Giovanni,
Jess whispered into her walkie-talkie, in as low a voice as she could manage. She sucked air in between her teeth and exhaled heavily, trying to ease the flood of adrenaline. Her hands shook.
Do you have Hector?
The walkie-talkie crackled softly.
In the brick schoolhouse, half a block behind you.
Jess turned the volume down. She peered behind her through the murk and saw an arm waving, 100 feet back on the opposite side of the street, behind the Range Rover.
Schoolhouse.
Indistinguishable from other piles of snowdrift-covered rubble.
And Leonie? He's with me. What can you see?
What can I see? Jess almost laughed. In the dying light, dirty snowflakes fell through an indistinct soup. Daytime was an oozing, sludge-brown twilight that clawed its way from the suffocating black of nights. The feeble rays of flashlights and headlamps drowned in the murky, aerosolized soup they breathed. It stank of rotten eggs, the sulfurous brimstone stench burrowing its way into the brain and filling their lungs with black phlegm, smothering everything in a pasty layer that scratched the eyeballs and coated tongues. Removing her goggles, Jess rubbed her eyes and strained to see through the semi-darkness. The temperature had dropped 10 degrees in the past 2 hours. Another frigid night. The Humvee's headlights barely pierced the muck.
There.
A head peered around the corner of what looked like the entrance to an open garage, no more than 100 yards away. A second shape appeared behind the first, the body and head twitching, more like a cornered animal than predator. Jess pushed the talk button.
I see 2, probably men. Do you see anything? Nothing.
Jess brushed snow from her face and pulled her gloves back on. 3-story buildings lined the street, some with windows still strangely intact. It reminded her of bombed-out villages she'd seen on her tour of duty in Afghanistan. Almost everything destroyed, buildings reduced to twisted piles of brick and steel. Yet every now and then a reminder of civilization endured, like the marble statue that stood untouched and defiant at this town's entrance as they drove in. The 2 figures ran, doubled over, behind the jumble of car parts blocking the middle. Had they seen Giovanni exit the rear car and run into the school? She had to act fast. This had been planned as an ambush, but the playing field was level now. Whoever had lain in wait for them had lost their advantage.
Leave Leone with the shotgun to protect Hector,
she instructed Giovanni over the walkie-talkie.
Then take Luca and Rafa down the side street south, sending them to you now.
She looked at Luca, his rifle gripped in white-knuckled fists, and flicked her chin in Giovanni's direction. The teenager crouched and took off at a half-run with his brother trailing.
I'm going up to the roof. When we get into position, toss 2 grenades into the open garage door of the red building. That'll force them out. Open fire from one side, I'll pick them off from the other.
Flank and flush. Static hissed over the walkie-talkie.
Maybe we'll just turn the trucks?
2 heads bobbed out from behind the burnt-out car in front of her, and one of the men jumped into the open to duck behind a pile of rubble 20 feet closer to Jess. Her hands tightened on the AK-47.
We need to scare them off.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.